Hi, this is Dr. Reuben here, and we're going to be talking about access cavity preparation and canal location. As far as I am concerned, this is the most important step in endodontic therapy. The simple reason, this is the first one, and if you go wrong at this stage, you are most likely to continue the same way.
So to make this soluble, let's split it into anterior and posterior teeth. As far as anterior teeth are concerned, we have all been taught to angulate the burr perpendicular to the long axis of the tooth and gradually straighten up as we enter the root canal space. But then, if you go and looked at a extracted incisor tooth from the mesiodistal direction, you will realize that all these canals have very little to do with the lingual surface. Even studies that have been done decades back have very clearly shown that all these canals project to the incisal, labial or the incisolingual line angle and have very little to do with the area around the cingulum. So when this is the case, why do we go around murdering the cingulum, which is supposed to be the stress-bearing area in an anterior tooth? So to do a proper access cavity preparation in an anterior tooth, draw an imaginary line above the cingulum, then another line at the middle incisal junction. A point that is present in the center between these two lines is where you have to initiate your access cavity preparation. So begin at this point, and as you gradually proceed, tilt the burr a little lingually and you're definitely going to drop into the pouch chamber. You really don't have to worry about perforating at all. Many have perforated an anterior tooth on the labial, but virtually none on the palatal surface. To top it up, the intact incisal edge of this tooth will prevent you from going too far lingually, and it's going to be absolutely safe when you do this. This is how you need to go about it. Begin at the center point between the line that is above the cingulum and the middle incisal junction. Gradually go down. Here in this case, I've cut the water spray on purpose just to make sure it doesn't obscure vision during documentation. If you can notice, I would gradually begin to tilt the burr lingually. And there, we're almost there into the pouch chamber space. Now, I would establish a good patency with my counting file. Use a coronal shaping file to widen the axis and also a brushing motion to eliminate the lingual shoulder. That's pretty much how it looks like once you have completed the access cavity preparation. You might want to extend your axis breadth a little wider just to make sure you do not leave any pulp tissue remnants behind. During clinical practice, we will come across a lot of anterior teeth with a fractured incisal edge. In that case, the access cavity preparation is a lot simpler and you can go ahead with your axis holding the burr parallel to the long axis of the teeth and go at it directly from the incisal edge. Something like this would be more than sufficient for good straight line access and convenient shaping and obturation procedures. Having discussed all this, I must also mention that the lower anterior teeth access preparation will require a few modifications. About 50% of your lower anterior teeth will have an extra lingual canal. And in case you do not widen your access cavity a little further lingually, you're bound to miss the lingual canal for sure. So this is how I go about a lower anterior access instead of beginning my access on the lingual surface. I initiate it directly on the incisal edge. When this is done, you get direct straight line visual access to both the lingual and the labial canal without compromising the strength of the cingulum. Now let's move on to the posterior teeth. For starts, these are the only two burrs that you will require, a good round burr and a non-end cutting burr. As a beginner, when you start your posterior root canal treatment, these are the three dilemmas that you will face. Where do I start? How far do I go? And how wide do I extend my access cavity preparation? Before even thinking of any of these three things, the first thing you have to do is de-occlude the tooth. Simple reason why, because we all know it is easier and more comfortable to work on a tooth which is much shorter. De-occluding offers three benefits. Firstly, it decreases your working length. Next, it increases your visual access to the pulp chamber and the orifices, and also decreases the interference both your rotary and hand files will face during the shaping procedure. Access cavity preparation can be best explained using three techniques. The first one is the radiograph based planning, the second one is the stress bearing cusp rule, and the third one is by far the most logical technique. It's called caries removal and tracing your way to the pulp chamber. So now let's discuss what this radiograph based planning is all about. And obviously, you will require a very good preoperative radiograph. The things you can ascertain from a good preoperative radiograph are that the pulp chamber is not present in this area. Neither is it present within that. So, your access cavity preparation has to be confined within the extent of the green zone. And if you can see, the black arrow shows the depth to which you need to penetrate to get into the pulp chamber. And if you can make a little observation, the depth to which this black arrow extends coincides with the location of the cemento-enamel junction. Studies have been done to show that this location of the cemento-enamel junction coincides with the roof of the pulp chamber in most of the cases. The cemento-enamel junction, being a readily available external landmark, can be used to guess the depth to which your burr has to penetrate to get into the pulp chamber by simply placing the burr alongside the tooth in the patient's mouth. Now let's have a look at the stress-bearing cusp rule. As we all know, it's the palatal cusp which is the stress-bearing cusp in the maxillary teeth and the buccal cusp in the mandibular teeth. Let's have a look at the maxillary premolar first. Begin your access on the tip of the palatal cusp, which is the stress-bearing cusp of a maxillary teeth, and extend it to a point that is 2 mm short of the buccal margin. Trace your way down gradually with a round burr until you come across something like this. As you go further down, you will feel a dip into the pulp chamber, and now all you have to do is place your non-end cutting burr into this drop and extend buccolingually until you have good straight line access to both your root canals. To sum up, as far as the maxillary premolars are concerned, the canals are present buccally and lingually. Limit your mesiodistal extension of the access cavity preparation. In addition to the two canal anatomy, you will also commonly come across a single oval canal present in the center in the maxillary premolars. Now let's discuss the mandibular premolars. Everything we had discussed for the maxillary premolar applies to the mandibular premolar as well. You will have to prepare a single oval canal extending buccolingually. The reason for this is that about 20% of your mandibular premolars will have a two-canal anatomy. And if we prepare a single circular canal right in the center, the chances of missing the second canal are very, very high. And so the axis is to be prepared in a way that that bit of dentine that has been marked by the black arrow there is removed, and we have adequate accessibility to negotiate and locate both the canals. One thing to remember as far as the mandibular premolar axis preparation is concerned is to hold the burr slightly tilted lingually to prevent undermining of the insignificant lingual cusp, or rather do not hold your burr absolutely straight when you prepare an axis in a mandibular premolar. A simple way of finding out whether the mandibular premolar has a single canal or a two canal anatomy is by assessing the position of your hand file inside the canal. If it is very well centered in the axis preparation, most likely it is to be a single canal anatomy. And in case you find your file clinging onto one of the walls, either the buccal or the lingual, the chances of it being a two canal anatomy are quite high. And in all mandibular premolars, it is very advisable to take multiple angle radiographs to see if there is an extra canal present. Just a couple of two canal mandibular premolar cases here. Now let's move on to the maxillary molar axis cavity preparation. As the stress bearing cusp rule states, begin at the stress bearing cusp, which is the mesiopalatal in this case. Extend the axis cavity to the buccal, 2 mm short of the buccal margin. Then extend it all the way to the buccal groove, forming a triangular axis outline. To explain in detail, begin at the stress bearing cusp, extend it 2 mm short of the buccal margin, then to the buccal groove, form a triangular axis cavity shape, trace it down until you feel it drop, deroof, and then you have your axis outline. From this stage, you will be able to put your scouting file into the distobuccal, the mesiobuccal, the palatal, and the MB2 canals. Remember that almost all your maxillary first molars will have the MB2 canal. But then the axis outline we have right now will not give us straight line access to the orifices. What we have at this point is called the mouse hole, where the orifices are present on the wall of the pouch chamber rather than on the floor. If you can look at the mesial half of this tooth, you might be able to appreciate the difference. To achieve straight line access from the current outline, use your non-end cutting burr at these three marked angles and shift the axis 1 mm wider to get unhindered access to the orifice and the rest of the canal. We will discuss the MB2 canal location a little further down in the presentation. And now the mandibular molars, and the same rules apply here as well. Begin at the tip of the buccal cusp, which is the stress bearing cusp. Extend to about 2 mm short of the lingual marginal ridge. Actually, you can stop your axis extension to the midline itself, because that's just where the mesiolingual canal is present. then extend to the buccal groove and trace down until you feel a drop. One other thing to remember as far as the mandibular molar axis is to go for a four-sided preparation, then a triangular preparation, because about 30% of your mandibular molars will have a fork canal anatomy. That's the mesiobuccal and the mesiolingual canal and the distal canal. One thing to remember as far as the distal canal location and straight line axis is concerned is the angulation of the distal canal mesially. So, you really don't have to extend your axis preparation too far distally. And that little bit of dentine can be preserved. There you have the mesial canals and the distal canals. An important thing to remember when it comes to the mandibular first molars is the existence of the middle mesial canal. And these canals are present under that lip of dentine which has been marked. So it is mandatory to eliminate that bit of dentine or include it in the axis cavity preparation to locate the middle mesial canal. Just a case with the middle mesial canal located and obturated. Remember, 10% of the cases will have a middle mesial canal. All said and done and everything discussed, the most logical way to go about an axis cavity preparation is by removing the caries. The main reason, or most often the reason why a patient visits a clinic for a root canal is caries. So, caries removal will merely trace this all the way into the root canal space. Just a case where the caries has been removed and it falls directly into the pulp chamber. Another maxillary molar where the caries removal almost completely gives access to the orifices. Another maxillary molar here again. And all these cases have been done with the help of a dental microscope. So I would definitely recommend that a beginner opens his axis much further, wider and not as conservative as this. Another case to sequentially explain whatever we have discussed so far. What you're looking at is the preoperative clinical image and radiograph showing caries on the mesial surface of the maxillary second premolar. That's the clinical picture. The tooth deocluded, caries removed, tracing down to the pulp chamber. We can see the bleeding spot here. All I'm going to do in this case is complete removal of caries and trace my way into the pulp chamber. As a beginner, in case you feel the air water spray of an air rotor is making visibility a little difficult for you, you can very well use a slow speed initially until you get comfortable. So we have almost completely removed the caries here. And there you can see the roof of the pulp chamber at this point. And that's the bleeding spot from the pulp chamber. So all we need to do from here is to de-roof the tooth to get access to the orifices. So I'm just de-roofing the tooth at this point. there the burr into the pulp chamber and me scooping out the roof of the pulp chamber. Just a little more refinement of the access cavity preparation. Left the very same case, obturated. Having discussed all this about access cavity preparation, it would be extremely incomplete if we do not discuss this one point as well. What you're looking at here is a very common clinical scenario that we all will come across. Most often, the reason for this is incomplete caries removal during the access cavity preparation. When you prepare your access cavity, if caries removal is incomplete, few years down, this is most likely what you will see. The tooth will not fail for endodontic reasons, but surely will have a very questionable restorative prognosis and longevity. So it's absolutely imperative to remove all traces of dentine during the access preparation stage itself. Now for a few tips on canal location. No lecture on access cavity preparation would miss this important finding by Krasner and Rankow in 2004. It states that all the canals will be present at the junction of the floor and the wall of the pulp chamber. Note the color difference between the floor of the pulp chamber and the wall. The floor is always darker than the wall of the pulp chamber. When I say all the canals are located at the junction of the floor and the wall of the pulp chamber, it only means that all the canals will be found at the junction where these lines intersect. This is another law that has been proposed to differentiate or find out whether a tooth, a mandibular molar, has either a three canal anatomy or a canal anatomy. Draw an imaginary line bisecting the line connecting your mesiobuccal and your mesiolingual orifices. If this line passes through the one distal canal you have located, it is most likely a three canal anatomy. And again, if this imaginary line which bisects the line connecting the mesiobuccal and the mesiolingual orifices passes alongside the one canal which you have located, you might have to go and look for an extra distal canal. Now a bit on the location of the MB2 canals. These MB2 canals are present in over 90% of the maxillary first molars. I would never be excited about finding an MB2 canal in a maxillary first molar, rather be really worried in case I don't find one. These MB2 canals are generally present about 2.5 millimeters from the mesial marginal ridge. So if you haven't extended your access cavity preparation about to that distance, you might want to push it that far to locate the MB2 canals. These numbers we're talking about here are common occurrences and not absolute values which will help you locate the MB2 canals. One common way of localizing the MB2 canal is by drawing an imaginary line connecting the mesiobuccal with the palatal, and then using this line we draw another 2 mm long line at about 10 degrees mesial to it. More often than not, you will find your MB2 canal lying on this red line here. Another common way to localize the MB2 canal is again by drawing an imaginary line connecting the mesiobuccal to the palatal and then a line perpendicular to this from the distobuccal canal Using the point at which they intersect as center, draw a semicircle of 1 mm radius. You will very commonly find your MB2 canal lying at this point as well. Small video to show me localizing the MB2 canal. Look at exactly where I'm dropping down, and you can actually notice the debris packing into the canal that is hidden underneath. I use a Moon's burr here. Alternatively, ultrasonic tips can be used as well. There you have the MB2. In case you are one of those dentists who believes that I have done thousands of cases, have never localized one MB2 canal so far, but none of my patients have come back with pain. If this is what you believe, the reason for this is most of these MB2 canals, though initially beginning as two separate orifices, as we go ahead with the shaping procedure, they gradually merge with the main canal, as in they have a 2-as-1 anatomy. This picture will probably better explain things. Appreciate the paper point in the MB2 canal being visible even through the mesiobuccal main canal. So this is exactly how most of us who do not clean shape and obturate the MB2 canal get away with a symptomless patient. So everything we have discussed so far are the common canal configurations. In addition to this, there will be minor variations that we will also come across in our day-to-day practice, and it's essential to be ready to handle them. The middle mesial canal of the mandibular first molar, which we had already discussed. The mandibular second molar, in addition to the 3 and the 4 canal anatomy, also comes with a common 2 canal anatomy. The MB2, which we had discussed about in the maxillary first molar, also quite commonly occurs in the maxillary second molar. The 2 canal anatomy of the maxillary second molar, we also have a 1 canal anatomy of the maxillary second molar. I will show you a case of that also. In addition to all this, you will also come across a few cases, but a little less frequently, which is going to be extremely hard to handle for a beginner. For example, the C-shaped anatomy is definitely going to be a very hard situation to handle. The 3 mesials, the 3 distal anatomy as well. The 1 mesial and the 2 distal, which is an absolutely reversed anatomy. You will come across cases like this as well. The lower incisors can come in a 1, 2 and a 3 canal anatomy also. What appears here as a single straight canal in this maxillary second molar is actually one canal from the orifice and splitting into 3 portals of exit in the apex. These canals are virtually not handleable without good magnification and adequate armamentarium. That's the post-operative radiograph of this case. We all teach axis opening saying, minute you reach the pulp chamber, you will feel the drop. But quite a significant amount of cases, you will not have this sensation at all. These are the calcified cases. The truth is, some of these cases can be handled, but some of them will be nearly impossible without a good operating microscope. The case you are looking at here is a perfect example. This was referred to me with inability to locate the distal canal. This probably was calcified in the first place, and the operator went around digging, looking for the extra canal. These cases, in case you do not handle them well right from the start, you might end up perforating them and make them absolutely non-functional. Most of the cases can be handled by a general practitioner and someone who has trained well in endodontic therapy. But then some cases better be transferred to the specialist who is better equipped to handle the situation.
So that's about it, and I hope to meet you again with Predictable Endodontics Part 2. Thank you.